साइंस डिग्रीज टू हिज प्रोफाइल. सर हैज डन मेनी वर्क्स. फ्यू ऑफ द सोसाइटल वर्क आर इज दैट ही इज द चीफ डिजाइनर ऑफ लो इंडियन cochlear implant program with successful outcome in the human clinical trials for the benefit of deaf and dumb persons. The specializations are many of them. Few are acoustics, hydrodynamics, sonar design, submersible design, ship magnetics, underwater electric field, infrared signatures, underwater explosions, metamaterials, and many more. There are several awards and honors of which you can of course see them. Sir is also the has the National Award for the Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities, Ministry of from the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, that was received from the Honorable Finance Minister in 2015. The National Award given by Vivid Lakshi Adyogi Samshodhan Vikas Kendra for Mechanical Sciences, from which was received from the Chief Minister of Gujarat, who is the current present Prime Minister Narendra Modi Saab. He also had the DRDO Technology Leadership Award, the DRDO Agni Award for Excellence, the DRDO Scientist of the Year Award 1993, which was received from the Prime Minister of India. The DRDO Silicon Trophy Award for outstanding contribution towards development of several level systems, the DRDO Technology Award for studies on gas turbines, the DRDO Certification of Commendation from Scientific Advisor to Defense Minister on National Science Day. Sir also has a gold medal from the Acoustical Society of America, a silver medal from the Acoustical Society of America in the year 2005. He is a fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering, a fellow of Andhra Pradesh Academy of Sciences. He was also categorized as the Stealth Man Best of Andhra Pradesh Honors, published by the Indian Express Group in 2007. Sir also has Suri Bhagwanatham Distinguished Acoustician Award in the year 2013. He is M.S. Narayanan Oration Award, M.K. Nambiar Oration Award by the Indian Association of Biomedical Sciences, and many more. And sir has also been the president of the Acoustical Society of India from the year 2007 to 2009, and currently he's also serving as the president of Condition Monitoring Society of India. Sir has patents, many of the patents, and some of them are listed here in the area of infrared signature suppression device. I welcome our distinguished speaker, and I'm very thankful that he has given his time for our FTP. Good morning and welcome, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sidra Kanam, for introducing me. Now, can I share the screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure.
Thank you. Just a minute, please.
Please share your PPT.
Yeah, I'm trying that. Has it come?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
I think this is the first slide. Okay. So, slide it is coming and abstracting me. Right. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And as part of your faculty development program, you have invited me to deliver this talk I think the program is on machinery condition monitoring. It is sponsored by AICT Training and Learning Academy, and it is a 5-day program. And thank you for making me a part of your program and asking me to deliver this talk. It is organized by Department of Mechanical Engineering, Allegheny Muslim University. And when Dr. Sidra Kanam asked me to deliver this talk, I really agreed, because it is always wonderful to give such a talk at to university, very prestigious university like Allegheny Muslim University. And Department of Mechanical Engineering is doing extremely good work there. I'm aware of it, so I also felt I should make this opportunity to meet people of your university and your department. So it's very nice, and once again, my thanks to you. Okay, we are conducting the 75th year of independence. So Ajadika Amrut Mahotsav is the program central government has asked us to celebrate. So let me also remember on this occasion that we have completed 75 years of independence. So my dear friends and distinguished guests, distinguished speakers, who are co-speakers are there, I think, all the 3-5 days, and very distinguished faculty, students, members of CMSI, and distinguished delegates, organizers of this program, ladies and gentlemen, once again, very good morning to all of you. So this is the title of the topic which I've been asked to deliver. So condition monitoring in industry for environment. So I have been already introduced, so I don't have to tell anything about me. So let us see. These are the words used, you know, what is industry for and condition monitoring. And you are already last 2 days, you know, you are hearing lectures on condition monitoring. I'm very sure you are aware of it. What is condition monitoring by now? And and some of you must be practicing condition monitoring, being from mechanical department. Though condition monitoring doesn't distinguish between departments, because it is subject of many departments. It is an interdisciplinary subject, and there are people in electrical, electronics, and many other departments, including materials, following condition monitoring techniques in their day-to-day works. So how are they connected? What is industry for? What is condition monitoring? How are they connected? See, this is going to be the basis of my talk. And you are already introduced to condition monitoring, as I can see from the lectures that you have heard. So let me go ahead. Hope you're all hearing me properly. Can anybody answer this? Do you hear me properly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Your voice is clearly audible.
Very good. Very good. Okay, let us move on. So what is industry for? I'm sure some of you would have known, but let me again introduce you. See, industry 4, we are now called Industrial Revolution 4. Basically, we are talking about 4 revolutions. Okay, so when was the first? When was the second? How is this is 4th? And this is what I'm going to explain very briefly. So it all started in, industrial revolution started way back in 18th century with James Watt, you know, inventing the steam engine. So when he invented it, then there was a mechanical power available, mechanical energy available to do things. So it changed the total scenario at that time. So that's why it was called a revolution. So it all started in industrial revolution. Though the mankind is there on this planet, and the first agricultural revolution all started almost, you know, 10,000 years back, but still it took so many years for industrial revolution like this. Started only in 18th century. Okay, so with that beginning, we had when we entered 20th century with the discovery of many, you know, electrical things, Faraday's laws, so many other things. So one could design electrical energy based systems. That happened almost early 20th century or late 19th century. It happened. So there is again second revolution, because that is the time when, you know, all the new machinery have come, spinning jenny, many, especially, you know, for for motorized systems, which all came used in textiles, used in mining, all these things. So it is that's why it is credited as Industrial Revolution 2. Okay, second Industrial Revolution. Now, third Industrial Revolution, I think people like us, we are all lucky. Maybe many of you are young because it all started in 1970s, we call it 1970s, it started, and we are very much aware of it because we are senior to you. So all of you were very young, and you might not have gone through this, but we have seen it. There is Industrial Revolution 3, and through the use of electronics, IT, further progression in many autonomous systems have started coming out from 70s, right? Before that, even we were not aware of this internet and the digital things. And even mobile phone came almost after 2000, almost. So there is this, but it's not a single revolution, a single discovery or invention. It is a multitude of inventions which made Industry 3 revolution. All combined, changed things. That's why it is said IT and electronics and all those things, right? Now we are talking Industry 4. Based on cyber physical systems. This is almost completely changing the scenario. Let us discuss more in the next slide. Yeah. So what is Industry 4? Many people have made many things. Actually, it all started, coining of Industry 4 started in Germany in one of the economic, I think meetings, big involving heads of the nations. So that is how they started calling it Industry 4. It happened about a few years back. I don't remember exactly, a few years back. So if the fourth industrial revolution creates deeply integrated relationship between technology and business, it is having very high impact on the society and business as in general, and globalization. It affected it as a you can say touched all the all kinds of all perspectives. It has touched, so it made the world further flat, and globalization has started in much more better way. So why they are called revolutions, as I mentioned earlier, because the innovation that drove them did not just improve productivity and efficiency a little bit. It completely revolutionized how goods are produced and how work was done. See, if you say some invention, okay, it helps you in increasing the productivity or increasing the efficiency or reducing the time or reducing the cost. That's the things we call inventions. Okay, and some of them we call very fast changes it can bring. Such inventions are also there. So, but all put together, it makes completely affects the technology, business, globalization, efficiency, productivity, then it is a termed a revolution. So we are in the fourth revolution, as I have mentioned now. So the general definition of Industry 4 is rise of digital industrial technology. In many definitions, many ways people are expressing it, it is a huge change. Okay, so it is a, some people said, put in terms of digital industrial technology, Industry 4 transformations allow us to work alongside machines in new, highly productive ways. I mean, different ways. In Industry 4, machines speak to machines. IoT is Internet of Things. Now, it is even people, when if you defense machine equipment, they're calling defense DIoT. Like IoT, IIoT has come, Industrial Internet of Things. Then it became Defense Industrial Internet of Things. Like that, people keep on expanding it. So basically, it is this IoT. And that's why it's a digital industrial technology revolution. So this has made a change. So the Industry 4 is all about digital industrial technology. Okay, as somebody has put it, I think Daniel Burris. So when we talk of IoT, what is that IoT? Digital transformation. What is the digital transformation? So this includes many things, especially you can see early 2000. Now we are in 22 years and more past. So in these 20 years, if you see many, many new things have come. Big data and AI was not known before that. It all started in early 2000s. Then cloud computing, AR and VR, virtual reality, augmented reality, IIoT, industrial internet of things, and additive manufacturing, 3D printing, 4D printing. People are even talking about 4D printing. Then autonomous systems, which includes robots, and which includes, you know, underwater submersibles, which are all autonomous, and driverless vehicles. All these things are there. Then simulation, digital twins. So again, very new digital twins, a concept in the last 3-4 years it has come, and cybersecurity, and many more. There, I think this list is not exhaustive. There are many things like edge computing. Then you talk of fog computing. Then many such things have come. Neural, deep learning, MIR are not listed, but I mean all these things put together helped to jump make a revolution, and that is what is fourth revolution. We are here now. What is condition monitoring? I will not explain because you're already aware of it, and it is just simply put, condition monitoring refers to monitoring of parameters that reflect the health of a machine or an asset. Machine in the sense, every machine, it could be a motor pump or compressor or a diesel engine or a gas turbine, any machine. Asset means need not be machines like this, things like dams, tunnels, and even such things, railway tracks, and even they are also assets. No, these assets also can be condition monitored using various technologies that are available to us today. So simply this kind of monitoring helps us in better planning, better maintenance, and efficiency, and many advantages are there. I'm sure in the previous lectures which you have heard, all these things would have been highlighted very well. All the distinguished speakers would have talked about it. So this is condition monitoring. Something is misspelled. So as mentioned, what is industry 4? What is condition monitoring? How are they connected? So this is again, this forms most part of my lecture, how they are connected, right? So importance of condition monitoring, I don't think I have to highlight much, but however, in industry era, I'm going to say condition monitoring is becoming the center pillar of industry 4. Please listen, please take note. Industry condition monitoring has become center pillar of industry 4. This is not just I'm saying, it has been published. You can see many articles have come. So you can see with the industry 4, the focus is shifting to improve operational efficiencies through automation, and condition monitoring solutions are front and center among the key IIoT technologies behind industry 4. They leverage predictive and cognitive analytics as well as machine learning to automate and streamline preventive maintenance. So that's why some of the authors, experts in this field, they have mentioned condition monitoring is the central pillar, or one of the important pillars of the industry 4 era. That is how the central condition monitoring has come to the central stage now. It was previously was restricted to only health monitoring of machinery, health monitoring of aircraft, health monitoring of a vehicle engine like that. But it is not like that. It is involved in many things, which I will explain now. So another author also said dzone.com, there are articles on condition monitoring. This is condition monitoring, a pillar of industry 4. Condition monitoring pillar in another Techmark PK, some another article, condition monitoring, a pillar of industry 4. If you see these articles, you will really realize how condition monitoring has become an important subject of itself. And it is now connecting all the cyber physical systems. Now let us also little look back about condition monitoring in retrospect. I thought this might not have been discussed or touched upon. Then I thought, but you must know. So that's why I said you must know some little history of condition monitoring in retrospect. It was actually almost 100 years, 1930s. Now we are in 2020s. These are over. We are also beginning of this thing. So this is almost 100 years, and in 30s and 40s, machinery was relatively basic, and there was not as much. You know, those days in 30, but there were no gas turbines, steam engines, and all that. There were some motors driven, small type of machines, which doesn't really need health monitoring. We don't need accelerometers. We don't need, you know, infrared sensors, you know, infrared images, all that. That was no need for that. But still, people have used condition monitoring. What is that? That is to increase, to insure the products, you know, like somebody want to go for insurance of his assets, like motors, machinery, or something, industry. They want to be some indication to say this machinery is health, I mean, working and healthy. That is what they use it first. So when the engineer T.C. Rathbone, he has even prepared curves called vibration curves in 1939. And from that he said smooth vibration, rough vibration, very rough vibration levels. He has fixed it for all the motors and all those things those days. And the data was used for fixing the insurance premium. If the machinery is having high level of vibration, intensity, then high amplitude of vibration, and then the insurance premium will be high. If it is a very smooth machine, insurance premium will be low. So that is how it started. But when it came to 50s and 60s, there was a huge development in the machineries itself. Gas turbine, first jet engine started coming from that, you know, in 45, 50. You can see the history of engines for aircraft. So they have become complex machinery, and they're very critical, and the reliability is very important, and sometimes lives are involved in travel when you have such machinery running the locomotives or aircrafts. So 50s, 60s, they started thinking using condition monitoring for fault detection and maintenance. That was the first time it has come. If you see in 45, 50, around that, this work started, people started using it. In some countries like UK, they even started using in the mining industry, in the mines, especially coal mines. You know, they started using condition monitoring, especially for bearings and all that, for pumps. So that was the origin of this. In 70s, which I had seen myself in 70s, I started measuring vibrations using condition monitoring. Those days we used to have, you know, tunable filters. Data was analyzed in laboratory. We had to go to the site to put a condition vibration meter, they record the data, bring it to the lab, then use, you know, there were no portable systems like now. In 80s, something what is called FFT has come, fast Fourier transform. It was actually discovered in late 70s, and by the time in 80s it became equipment. Arrival of FFTs, and those FFTs also are tabletop type things. So still there was difficulties. Only in 90s they become, you know, very small size, and one can carry in the hand. In 80s, FFTs, microprocessors, because of that the data analysis has become. It's not only I'm talking about vibration. Many the same thing happened in all the areas, like infrared signatures, for example. The infrared cameras were costing 40 lakhs, 50 lakhs those days in 80s and 90s. Only in 2000 onward, the cost of the infrared cameras have come down drastically. Now it is much more cheaper. Okay, so technology made condition monitoring much easier and much finer, much accurate. So over the period, it became very important, important tool for the engineers to assess the life of the life and health of the health and state of the machine. So 80s arrival of FFTs, fast Fourier transforms help. 90s laptops have come, where software packages gave all computers memory storage, data collection. Those days data was collected and written in a notebook and brought it, and sometimes we used to tape record it, bring the tape to the lab and play it and replay it and analyze the data. So all that things have gone. Now everything you can do at the site itself. In 2000, wireless data transfer arrived, and the methods of reporting analysis, this is much, much simpler. For example, somebody want to, like Bakra Nangal or Nagar Sagar Dam, you want to measure, see the condition of the dam by the civil engineers. So you have to put at least maybe 100, 200 sensors, and it is. So you cannot go and sit in the dam and take measurements there. Now everything is made wireless. So data comes from those sensors. They're all sometimes self-harvesting energy, or sometimes battery-based small batteries, which can give a longer life. Very less power consuming sensors are there, and they're all wireless. They keep transmitting, and you can sit as far away as 1,000 kilometers, and you can still record the data and analyze it. So that is how now the systems have changed. And I think is one of the, I can say, very easy for the engineers to use condition monitoring approach to analyze systems than compared to 70s when we started this work. Okay. The 20s condition monitoring became central to industry 4. Okay, that is what, let us see. You also agree or not? At the end of it, you must tell me condition monitoring is very important or not. Okay. Is it asset? In the industry 4, it is going to play a major role. I think this is, we should discuss at the end, and discuss more on that, right? Thank you, let me go forward. So condition monitoring is just not for maintenance. This again, I want to stress at this stage, because people, there was the impression when we started the society in 2003, people were all telling, it is only for maintenance purpose. So I used to argue with them, no, it is not. So if you see, condition monitoring can improve the design of the machine, reliability of the machine, it can improve the quality of the machine, the efficiency of the machine, many things. The total design of the machine can undergo a change if you have a lot of data about condition monitoring. Whichever you collected, you started for maintenance, but the data that you got on a particular kind of machine, if you apply and see that, the machine can be redesigned with much higher reliability. So it is also called RCM, reliability centered maintenance, which I'm sure would have been discussed. So reliability of the machine at the end is a goal, not the maintenance. So once you have such a reliable machine, automatically maintenance will come down. Maintenance cost will come down. Efforts to health monitor also will reduce. That is one. Other one is TPM, total productive maintenance. I'm sure you would have heard this. I have mentioned here what is a TPM also. So in a poorly performing maintenance and operations organization, the gap between the real and ideal world tends to increase over time, because the organization reacts to problems instead of preventing them. See, some of the organizations are their attitude, the management attitude is different. Even now, that's why in some industries they don't use condition monitoring, and they pay in a different way for not using condition monitoring. So in some organizations, I can say maybe 10, 15 years back or 20 years back, TPM was very popular because sometimes, you know, say in an organization, some machine breaks down, and some immediately the maintenance team will report to their management that the machine broke down, and we have to replace the so and so many parts or so many bearings or a gearbox or whatever it is, they will say, and you sanction amount for buying a gearbox or buying a new bearing so that the machine can be immediately started. Then the management will immediately sanction that amount, because otherwise there is a machine breakdown, that means there is a output also will not be there. The process plant is disturbed, and many such things will happen. Finally, the company will not be able to produce the products on time because some machine has broke down. So they immediately rush, give money, sanction, urgent, buy, put it immediately, keep the machine on. But the same maintenance team, have they asked the management, say 6 months before, based on condition monitoring, that this particular machine is unusually high vibration or high the temperature profile or infrared imagery or oil, you know, oil debris analysis, all these are showing that this machine is heading for failure, so and so component requires replacement, so let us buy it and keep it in advance. They will not sanction. The management say no, why to invest money unnecessarily, let it fail, we'll see. In case that when it really fails, everybody gets hurried. And so this is called total productive maintenance. That means In maintenance, it is not the maintenance team's job alone. In maintenance, it is the management also, like finance people or HR people, everybody should appreciate this and they should keep sanctioning them well in advance so that you can keep important items which comes out of predictive maintenance studies, that these should be stockpiled. We are going to have this problem in. So that is what is called TPM. So all these are the long-term benefits of condition monitoring. Condition monitoring is important, not just for maintenance purpose, regular maintenance or something. It is for producing a most reliable machinery and also making the organization very effective. I know one case, for example, Hindustan Petroleum in Visakhapatnam, there was one compressor and the compressor started giving very high vibrations. And they called some of our teams and we immediately said that there is a coupling which is having problem and we have to replace the coupling. And they did it when the lean time in the night when the production is stopped, immediately they replaced it in few, say less than an hour, because we kept everything ready and did it. So that was the importance, because otherwise they said if that machine breaks down, for example, for say one day, then the southern part of India will not be having petrol and fuel supply within next 2 days. There will be a big calamity. That is the importance of that machine. Okay, the machine costs few crores. It's a big compressor. So these are the sudden failures of machinery can cause such a damage. It is both public inconvenience to the public in the field. I mean, many industries will stop, many movement of vehicles will stop if we don't produce petroleum in time properly, supply it and all that. Okay, this is an example I'm giving. So condition monitoring is so important, and all mechanical engineers definitely should know, and all other disciplined people also is being interdisciplinary should practice condition monitoring in their own way. So what has happened prior to Industry 4? So we talk of condition monitoring prior to Industry 4, which I have explained to you in some already. So the ability to monitor condition of assets 24/7 from any location with person in loop has been the trend of maintenance practices. So I think CMS also started in 2003. That was the thing. Suppose you want to monitor a particular machine, one has to monitor 24/7. And one has to, from any location, persons should be there. Human being should be kept there. Watch keeping should be done. Then maintenance equipment, I mean recording equipment, instrumentation should maintain. That was the. I mean, there has to be a lot of movement of persons and movement of equipment, and people should sit in the location where the machine is to be monitored. It was that kind of thing, and it was a huge. Huge work, a lot of work for the teams, and they have to abandon their regular works, that rush to the place, sit there, use it. So now that situation is changed because EM detects failures in early stage, the maintenance planning action can be optimized and catastrophic failures prevented. Depending on the consumer systems, it can also be used for a predictive forecast, remaining useful life of machinery. All these things can be estimated today. There are people also talking life cycle maintenance. People can calculate, know how the machinery should be prepared for life cycle maintenance, so that that will be in an efficient organization. That is very important. Similarly, signal processing techniques, feature extraction, fault detection, fault monitoring, fault reanalysis, and there are varieties of such things with significant human effort. They all needed human effort. A lot of human effort is required. Now that is reduced machining. Now we can see from the vast amount of data, we can find out, extract some of the features because of big data analytics and all that. So we can get much more information. So in 2022, now we are in, so machine integrated sensors, wireless sensors, collection data collection and everything. And we have a cloud-based systems. So data can be stored, like for example, aircrafts today, Airbus or this Boeing's, you know. So they have condition monitoring systems and the data is transmitted to, there are a few ground stations in the world. So to those stations, nearest station, the data is transmitted and data is analyzed there, which can be analyzed on the aircraft, is analyzed, which is analyzed, which can be analyzed on the ground, it is analyzed. Cloud is used for transferring data. And there are specialists waiting in one place. Instead of somebody has to go with every aircraft, one person sending is very difficult, right? But sitting in one place, there are, you can see in the, Google, you see there are some places for that. They can analyze the data, the experts, expert knowledge can be used. So when the aircraft lands, immediately, if there's a necessity to change some parts or something, analyze the lube oil, analyze, check the pressure, change pressure measurements and things like that. So all that can be done, and it is done even without the knowledge of the pilot. Pilot doesn't know anything. Previous years, pilot also is involved in that. When something happens, immediately he has to send the information down. No, he himself may not know that his engine is having some problem, but the ground operating people will know that because of the technology available today, and is all because of wireless sensors and data handling capabilities now, all those things. So that is a change. When we started a customer service of India, many people used to ask this, as I said, for health, for just monitoring of maintenance. Then I used to tell them, no, things are changing, and once we improve in our sensor technology, and the importance of CMSA will go up. So I am very happy that today CMS is a central pillar of condition monitoring, and the society is doing very well. And Dr. I think Sidra Kanam is our one of the executive members of society. Right. Yeah, so just a little repetition here. The smart sensor allows continuous condition monitoring. There is one which I brought out in the previous slide. There are very smart sensors are having their intelligent sensors, and power is harvested in some cases, and they consume very less power, and this kind of, they can transmit their RF, everything is there. So that's why it's called smart sensors, and continuous monitoring is possible 24/7, and data facilities and intelligent stations using predictive data. People are now talking data analytics. You might have used the word very often these days, data analytics. Okay, so basically analytics is basically mathematics and statistics, those kind of subjects. So that's why condition monitoring has become a subject of those disciplines also. We have used words business analytics. So in here it is data analytics, and is very, very important. And many new theories have come up in data analytics, and one can dig out of the data by using this analytics. Some new features which will be very, very helpful, which otherwise would have escaped. It is beyond human beings to analyze the data to that extent. So it is not just data mining, it is much more advanced than data mining. Okay, and people don't talk about CPUs now. I think they use GPUs and TPUs, graphical, and data quantity increases. So people are talking TPUs and all that, right? So another thing, remote monitoring data is collected from a given asset without the need of 24/7 person. That is, I have already explained to you. Today, assets can be operated at their peak performance while implementing a condition monitoring maintenance plan. Sometimes, we cannot do peak performance when we are taking measurements for various reasons. And whereas that is possible here, because it is a human beings can go there without going there, it is done. So then the many reasons, like one is accidental risk is not there, one explosion or some other failures may cause difficulties for people to go nearer to the system. So they run at the lower efficiency, lower performance level, they don't use peak. So, but here it is possible, you can measure. And if you get measured peak performance, then you get more realistic data about the failure analysis. So massive data is generated real time in various, once you are measuring 24/7, the data is too much, So there were time when people used to dump the data, what we'll do with that, we are lost the data. In fact, one of my teachers used to tell me, don't measure so much data, you will get lost, because you will get confused having so much data. But now today, data is very important. Collect as much data as possible, feed into your data analytics, and they it will give you some new trends. Okay, it gives you new data from extracted from and any kind of, you know, such trends can be come out of such real time data. So the thinking itself changed. Okay, what we used to call, you know, we'll get lost in the data. Now we are telling, no, we need more data, right? So artificial intelligence is responsible for selecting which machine learning models are applied, maintaining. We'll come to that. So before Industry 4, if we talk, there were only two subjects which supported the condition monitoring. One is physics-based knowledge, other is knowledge-based knowledge. Knowledge-based means we used to have baseline signature, we have average signature, we used to use these kind of words, you know, smooth signature, and then compare it with the previous and later versions of the same machine that for comparison. So that kind of knowledge. Physics-based is what is theory behind it, how lube oil temperature will change with the running speed and things like that are all calculated using some fourth order equations, second order differential equations, and or some such things, all physics based concepts. So these two put together, experts using simulations, some we used to write, you know, expert systems and all that. We used to call in condition models, there were expert systems those days, to just yes, no, we keep answering, then at the end we get expert's view. So this is what before Industry 4, it was basically physics based and knowledge based. Now, as I explained, it is now added with the database. Now, this is the database, the common systems, you know, there are no gray box models, expert systems, and experts using simulation software, experts using AI and deep learning, neural networks, then federated learning and things like that. So this is what is Industry 4 based condition monitoring. It's not just physics or data, I mean knowledge, it is also data based. And data based is slowly gaining more and more importance. So this is the effect of Industry 4, because in Industry 4, digitalization, collection of data, transmission of data, storage of data, handling of data, everything has become simpler, easier. And so many new data-based digital-based systems have come, which made easier for the to do such data-based analysis. Now combine that with the physics knowledge and data, and you get a better analysis, better picture of the state of the machine, a state of the asset in which you are using condition monitoring for analysis, right? So this is again digital transformation, CM, ubiquitous, condition monitoring ubiquitous. These are all cloud, edge, big data, predictive, 5G, all these things are there, which I listed. The list is more and more, day by day, more increasing. Blockchains have come, digital twin, agile methodology, that means flexible. Methodology has become flexible now. AR and VR, right? So this is a condition monitoring expert should know at least some of these things in depth so that he can make a better better contribution and better prediction, predictive maintenance, and help the industry. Okay. Here is one example of integrated condition monitoring systems. We have in the bottom most is a physical space. The topmost three pictures are cyberspace. And in between we have cyber physical space, cyber physical interface, basically. Right. Now you just see how, once again, smart condition monitoring for Industry 4 manufacturing process and ontology based approach. So data from machines, tools, environment, product, process that are available. So because we have designed the machines, we know design data, we know operational data, we know performance data, as you know, we know all indications. When you're using, for example, you talk about major diesel engines, for example, propulsion used, propulsion machinery in ships or gas turbines in case of, you know, aircrafts, such systems. So that is in a physical scenario. In cyber scenario, we have now machine degradation model, knowledge based model. So many models are available. No fault trees, data. I mean, even I am not aware of all these things. And youngsters like you, you should now catch on with this. There are many, many new models have come, knowledge based, statistics based, varieties of them. That is the available in cyberspace. Now the you have to feed the machine data, and you also collect the data driven by physical model, machine health model, all these things you have to. You can see the arrows from bottom to top it is going. And finally, you reach a knowledge-based model, and from knowledge-based model, you get prediction. That prediction can be used, whether there is any loss of quality, any damage, alarm is to be raised, or fault diagnosis to be done, or maintenance actions can be done. All that comes, and now that comes back to the that is all again in the computer in the cyberspace, but we need in physical space. So you can see arrows at the end. They are shown downwards. That means there is an interface. It comes to the human beings and the operators, or you can say maintenance team, those people, they get info in the form of plots and or decisions taken, and such things can be happening. So this all put together is called condition monitoring based an integrated analysis. Okay, for it is industry 4. This is going to be the mainstay. This is going to be the mainstay of doing condition monitoring now. I already mentioned about this wireless sensor condition monitoring. This is now all wireless sensor networks are available. It's not just individual, they're all networks. If nearby sensor is not working, and another sensor can take over its job. And also like that, even power, the power is also distributed, data is also distributed, data can be sent in a particular order. So all these things can be played with. This is for soldier.com, they have, I think, given this picture. Wireless sensor networks are very useful for condition monitoring of rotating components like helicopter rotor blades. Yeah, some of the places, they're rotating components. You can't measure in a rotating system. So they are non-contact sensors also are there. And the contact sensors are there. Similarly for turbine blades, these are running inside, inside the system. So you have to measure from the casing. So that is also possible. And similarly, as I mentioned, examples like dams and tunnels, huge tunnel is there. For example, 10 kilometers lengthy tunnels are also there, even more maybe. So even those areas and people are using it, these sensors. Even people are now using, monuments like Taj Mahal and all that. People can do condition monitoring. One need not go to the every time Mahal and do analysis. It can be done now. And what kind of humidity, what kind of temperature, what kind of this moisture in the structure in different times of the year, all that can be monitored, and the data can be collected. And these are all MEMS, and very cheaper cost, not very costly sensor. They're very made cheaper these days, and so and we can use them in hundreds and things like that. It is used even in such purposes. So I'll give you a few examples of such kind also. So this, I think I'll explain to you. This is basically system architecture. This is what my one of previous slides is shown in a different fashion here. Otherwise it is same. We have data loggers, then goes to cloud, then analytics tool, predictive analytics, because the analysis persons need not be at the site. That is the most important thing here. Site and operation measurement is one team can be doing it. And through cloud, it goes to the experts who are at different places. Now we can put more experts in one place. Otherwise, you have to have so many experts distributed everywhere. Now that is, it is like analogous to medical system, which is also more or less running in this fashion. Now, some experts you can consult in US, some experts in US can consult Indians also, depending on their capabilities and effects, like that here also. So this, which are the top applicable condition monitoring in the world at this as on today? This is the, I think, very recent, reasonably recent report 3-4 years back. Energy sector is using condition monitoring, process plants, petrochemicals, oils, then like HPCL, this Indian Oil, So construction, mining, they're using heavy, this is the order actually, heavy industry, military, armed vehicles, weapons, system, fighters, helicopters, all kind of warships, all submarines. All submarines are fitted with condition monitoring systems, helicopters are fitted, warships are fitted, varieties of sensors. And railways, now railway in Indian government recently has made condition monitoring in one of their, you know, vision document they have made. Okay, in the vision document, they have put condition monitoring as one of the application to improve the safety of the reliability of the railways. And it is helping a lot. I'll give an example in my thing. So computer applications, IBM is using condition monitoring, food manufacturing, people are using condition monitoring in this order. Okay, so there is, the scope is to, I mean, almost encompasses into all the industries. So as I mentioned in railways, this is one company, Electronics, they produce condition monitoring equipment for the railways. Now, in fact, every station, nearly 700 or 800 stations, they have these systems are located. And data loggers are there. Data loggers means the sensors are there, data is logged. Analysis is done at certain important stations, and they have found, you know, many accidents that is happening. Generally, at the end of the accident, they conduct a review, or a committee will go into the region to find out the details. So those details, now they're very happy with this data available. They're able to pinpoint it, and many accidents are now stopped because of this. Previously, it was not stopped, because once the accident is over, analyzing and coming to the reasons for the accident is somewhat difficult. But with these systems now available in India, almost this particular company is supplying this kind of systems. They're all, you can see, IoT edge systems, predictive maintenance systems, remote condition monitoring, predictive maintenance system, and certification is done, prescriptive solutions, software also they will give. All this is, I mean, why I'm telling you, we are thinking we are behind in this matter. It's not that, only things are happening silently. If somebody has got interest, he can learn. Yes, such things are happening. Okay, it is some Vijayawada based company, but they're having a footprint in all the stations now. And railways are using very regularly of this. Now, every station has got a data logger which records many data, like, you know, some data regarding rails, some regarding wheels, some about the compartments, some are remotely monitored systems. Okay, such things are there today in our country itself. Remote control monitoring, offshore wind turbines. This is, people are now very happy. Offshore, the wind is always availability, intensity wise is very high. So if you go for offshore wind turbine, they may break more even profit wise. So they break even. So people are going for that. But maintaining the offshore wind turbine is not easy. That is the problem, main issue. But now because of this remote condition monitoring, so even those kind of things have become much easier now. So people can, you can go with the parts, change it and come back, rather than going, checking everything. I mean, going on a seashore, on offshore, you know, on a sea, is very difficult, you know, it costs more, and the efforts are required also very high. So such things are reduced, and it is becoming very popular offshore. There are systems available in the market now. Funding strategy, hydropower plant, same thing. And very many places, one cannot even go to the sites. Those sites, only few engineers will be there. So now all the data, even it helps those engineers also. So this is also being practiced in some hydro power plants in India. Not all, some of them. Digital twins is again somewhat recent concept. So you can have a physical asset, you can have a digital twin of it. Everything is modeled thing. And it is very useful, because you can simulate the fault and see the response in hand. And accordingly, you can design it. And condition monitoring can be done. The data, this particular process is done through condition monitoring, basically. Digital twins. Okay, And not only that, suppose these days, like, you know, International Space Station, some machinery is not working there, for example, or giving some, we have to see the, it's working, then we can have a, its physical asset on the ground. And we can simulate some of the positions, some of the conditions there, and we can analyze it and give feedback to the people who are there in the International Space Station to correct it or change it, whatever it can be done. So such a things have been done. I'm not telling you that can be done. It is, such things have been done already in NASA related organizations and Russia also. So this is the importance of it. Now this is very, one should know about digital twins and all that, because very high, a lot of good future is there, this particular area of work, digital twins for optimizing maintenance and condition monitoring. Especially in, during warfare also, sometimes, you know, American helicopters, they come to this faraway places like Iraq, Iran, where they were fighting. So this is most of this data were monitored in US through digital twins. What is happening, any problem with any helicopter and everything, they were monitoring regularly and giving information back to the maintenance engineers in the, at the site of fighting going on. So it is used for both good purposes, and during war it is used for space space systems based analysis required that time also, people are using it. Now people also talk about virtual reality and predictive analytics, and in fact we can see, if we take a gearbox for example. Now, when gearbox is working, it's not meshing, or it is loosely meshed, or there is a misalignment problem is there, unbalanced problem is there, or some fuel lube oil supply is there. We can simulate that in virtual reality. We can create lack of fuel, increasing in lube oil, or increasing the lube oil, excess lube oil, or faulty lube oil. And we can see how the machine will work in that conditions and see that really. There are some videos, if you can interested, you can see that, I think South Carolina University and 2-3 universities that way, Fraunhofer Institute, they have put videos in their site. One can see virtual reality, one can feel by injecting a problem, you can see how it is going to respond in physical mode. You can see that. So that means we can take a feedback from that. If the system is working in the physical mode, the reason must be this. So that kind of correlation can be done, and it is extremely well adopted, and it is coming up. In India, it is a good area for research, and how virtual reality can be become another way of predictive analytics doing. Okay. This you can see of fault progression in the wear of gears and how it affects the health of the gear, showcasing an Apache. Is a very famous company, you know, helicopter company in America, tail rotor drive train intermediate gearbox. Okay, their videos are there, please see that. I'm not showing here. Condition monitoring, aircraft monitoring. In fact, we have a LCA program. Now there was a meeting where I attended. They're going to spend about 400 crores only condition monitoring of aircraft. See, aircraft branding is not that aircraft is made ready and available. It can become part of the aircraft while aircraft is designed. For example, wing is there. Wing is basically, you know, composites. We can have a fiber optics line running in the wing. When the wing is making unusual vibrations or, you know, over loading for different load conditions, the fiber optic gratings will give information. It is part of the system. It is there in the wing. It is permanently there, and it keep giving information. So that means we have to, in the design of the wing itself, we have to take into account to embed condition monitoring system in it. Whether this kind of situation will be there in many places, and where we can integrate. So already, of course, in turbines and all, they call OEs, OEMs. They give already permanently installed sensors. But now the cost of the sensor, the size of the sensors, miniaturization, data collection, data, all become easier. So you can have, instead of 1-2 sensors very carefully purchased and chosen, instead of that, you can have hundreds of sensors. So that is what is making condition monitoring aircraft is very important, because the health is the life of the people are involved. Cost is very high of the asset. So this kind of mentoring is very important. Now it is becoming part of the aircraft design. That's why it's a 400 course project and so much of information is required. Bench monitoring for maritime operations also. You today all marine, especially things which go on sea at high seas, they have problems with engines and all that, very difficult to attend and repair them, maintain them, bring them back. Sometimes no, the asset life itself is under danger. No, so for that, this marine offshore, since they are specialized, which can withstand corrosion and other environments, we have such systems which are available. And for monitoring every part, whether it is a shaft, it is a propeller, or it is an engine, or you know, any such things can be monitored. And these systems are very, very popular, and people are using it. And there is a separate design for submarine health monitoring systems are there. And so similar like aircraft health monitoring, vehicle health monitoring, we have submarine structure health monitoring is also very important. It is there. It's again another new area for Indians to start work on that. Research students can work. Subsea cable condition monitoring. You know, so there are subsea cables. You know, 99.5% and more of internet traffic in the world is through these cables. Many people think it is due through space. No, it is not through space. It is through cables, underwater cables, which runs thousands of miles rather. Okay, they conduct 99.5% and more internet traffic. So you know the importance of that. Sometimes one cable goes and 2-3 countries will be disconnected from internet today. That kind. So monitoring of these cables is very important. And in the industry 4, with all the digital things, this has become much more easier. Now, along with the cable condition cables, they also lay one thin fiber optic grating sensor. It has got fiber optic gratings at different locations. If there are unusual bending or loads due to sea waves or earthquake waves, and those kind of things, and those cables respond, and that can be easily located today. Where is the fault? Which fiber optic grating is giving data? From there, it is coming data. They can go to that particular spot, lift the cable, repair the cable, and drop back into the water. So such systems are available in the market, and people, there are experts able to do this work. So they have divided the cable every, you know, kilometer wise, 5 kilometer, 10 kilometer region. They know which part of the, because it's thousands of miles, you know, as I said, thousands of kilometer. So which part of 10 kilometer segment is at fault, one can predict from either end of the cable interface. So this is one of the, again, breakthrough things which is happening today in the world. All of us may not be aware of it. Such things are happening, and subsea cable condition monitoring is done. Okay, defense systems. I talked about South Carolina University doing it for helicopters. Basically, they are done for Apache helicopters. So most of main battle tanks, helicopters, all these are fitted with now these kind of condition monitoring systems. It was not the case some years back. Now, because of Industry 4 and this kind of things, our digitalization systems available, we're able to do it, both diagnosis and prognosis. That is, even predicting, you know, in much advance, not only analyzing the fault, even suspecting the fault is also possible, predictive analysis. Steel industry, I don't have to mention, each steel industry will have full of machinery. For example, Visakhapatnam steel plant, I inquired, they said they have 25,000 motors in their steel plant. Okay, like that, they have compressors, pumps, and various equipments which need condition monitoring in a regular manner. And they're all having now, very fortunate that people have realized, some steel plant may not be, I don't know, old ones, but all the new ones, they're having it. And in fact, we have a Tata Steel plant and the Condition Monitoring Society of India last January 2021 January, we had an international conference which was attended by 2500 people at one point of time. The minimum 1500 always there, because Tatas are well known industry in the world. So because of their brand name and Consumer Society of India's proper preparation, so we could attract that kind of listeners, audience for that. It was such a hit conference. Being practiced in industry today, for example, you know, Kirloskar pumps, they supply pumps and motors, also supply today a mobile type system which one can use it to go to the particular motor. You can use the data trending and all that that will give in that machine, all the vibrations. One need not go to Kirloskar motor to measure it. They already embedded such sensors, and this all the sensors will be transmitting data, and data will be analyzed, and this pocket sized mobile kind of system is available and at hand. You can use it now. So this is what, again, good research area. That means a lot of ML and deep learning was done, and they have, for their motors, for their pumps, they have done, and this can be done for many in the many systems, which is many complex systems. This is a simple system. So such things available in the market today in India, where ML is used already, AI and ML. So this is another good example of condition monitoring. You know, these two products you keep seeing in the market, in the advertisements, Kent, they say buy our RO plant and take the product, it costs some 10,000 or whatever it is. There is the other side, which is famous Sachin Tendulkar is advertising. He says this system is available free, but pay for the service. How much water you drink, that much only you pay. Okay. He says zero machine cost, zero maintenance cost, zero installation cost, zero security cost, zero hidden cost, nothing. You just give a ring, he will come and his company will come and fix the system, give you a system at home and go. Now, similarly, washing machines, you know, dishwasher, they're all having now IoT. Fitted, you know, you might have seen the latest machines coming, the IoT based systems, and which you can leave in the you know, house owner can operate it remotely. He need not go to the machine every time. He can remote it, remotely monitor. Some servant maid can help putting the dishes inside, and but he can monitor, or she can monitor from a distance. So this is the pay for the service, only pay for the product. How it happened? Yeah, this is because the one which is Kent is a conventional machine. The one which Sachin Tendulkar advising, Live Pure, is a smart machine. Smart in the sense it is fitted, it is IoT enabled, it has got a Wi-Fi, it has got an edge connect. That means edge computer is there. Then the data goes to cloud. Then there is ERP software. There is internet dashboard. Predictive analytics is there. Because something goes bad, it can first level screening of fault. It can do data analytics. Can mean the data of how many glasses of water is consumed, how many liters consumed, all such data, so that it can go to the finance department to make a bill and send the bill. And it is a 4G enabled as well as 5G also. It is enabled. So this is a smart. So this is because of the industry 4. And condition monitoring is there because the purpose is condition monitoring. The purpose is when this doesn't work, you should get the information, not only charges. It should, if any problem is there, we should be able to solve it. And why it is edge connected? Because most of the analytics is incorporated in the edge computer itself. It need not go to cloud computer, which is 500 kilometers or 1000 kilometers away. Whereas edge is just on the system itself. It can do some amount of analysis which is required. Only cloud is only for, you know, charges, how much money to be paid and how much money is to be invoiced, those kind of data. Or to get a overall picture, suppose you have sold 1000 pieces and all 1000 pieces of data will go through cloud for some certain data. Whereas local problems can be in the edge computer, major problem can go to cloud computer, and the software is designed accordingly. And you know the dashboard. You can see the owner himself can see the dashboard, what, how much water is consuming every day he want to see. And anybody can see in the local maintenance or in center, the companies, you know, headquarters, they can see. So this is what is basically why condition monitoring becomes center of industry 4. So the purpose is that. That's why they say this is now what I said is example is a very simple example of RO plant, and such systems are available in the market. Even in Bangalore, I know some people are selling such new systems. You don't have to pay for the cost of the machine, cost of the RO plant, but you can take it, pay only water, how much you drink. If you take 3 liters, you pay for 3 liters per day, like that. So this is applicable for other systems also, washing machines in future, even like, even our refrigerators and all that is going to come this kind, and including, you know, especially coolers, ice coolers, this kind of system, many, many systems. I mean, slowly it is increasing now. We will see such advertisements in the future. This is all because of Industry 4 and condition monitoring married together. So it's a very the trend is very good. Condition monitoring global market, you can see there is a increase of 5 to 6% per annum. It will be there up to 2023. Global machine condition sensors market also is increasing, which you can see this. I can leave you this PPTs with you. Wireless sensor technology provides substantial growth advantages over wired sensors. According to report, we can see IoT-enabled predictive maintenance could potentially save manufacturers 200 billion to 600 billion by 2025. There is a saving. See, another important is this is not just for the purpose. It is there is a saving on for the manufacturers and marketing strategies. Everything it helps. See, there is an importance in India, abroad also. Skill development is urgent need to invest in technology and people training focus. So I'm very happy FDP has chosen this topic. I think every university, every engineering college should think of this topic. This has got very wide, disciplines it covers, and it need not be only restricted to one department. It can go to many other departments. People can have these condition monitoring FDP programs, and then such programs are there in Condition Association of India also will help in giving lectures. Some of my colleagues are giving lectures in this FDP program arranged by Dr. Sidra Kanam. Okay, so there is a lot of scope. There is, it can become part of the training, your course material also. We can have a subject on this. This I don't have to tell you are all academicians. You can, you know how to plan it and incorporate in your training programs. The future is very high, and not only that, abroad also there is a huge demand for skilled people in this area. If somebody trained, you will get a very good chance to go abroad and work. It is not my aim to send them out of country, but being a expanding country, such things are also good opportunities for our Indians. So thank you. I want to stop at 10:30. I've taken 2 more minutes more. So half an hour is left for any doubts and clarification discussion. You can use it for that. Okay. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity. And Dr. Sidra Kanam, thank you very much for you especially. And I want you to take forward with your colleagues and all the people who are attending the CMSI, Condition Monitoring Society of India activities, still forward and forward. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Most welcome, sir. Now I request the participants to post their queries, or if you have to discuss anything with professor, then you can post your comments in the chat box. That will be taken up. So we have a question from our participant Rahul Kumar Sinha.
Yeah.
Can I read it out for you?
Yes.
Yeah. What roadblocks do you see, sir, in implementing Industry 4.0?
Okay, very good question. See, this is debated everywhere. It's not just we are only discussing this. And Industry 4, as you have seen, mainly right kind of personnel required. That means the engineers who are coming out of the colleges, they should be properly trained in ML, AI, some of these new subjects, And then sometimes people see Aldheim and you know, you can become a data scientist without a technical degree, and they're all not correct. It is not possible. A real data scientist has to have a very good background. So those who are computer science, those who are in mathematics, statistics, they also can take part in this. And mechanical engineers, as I explained you how many plays, the importance is growing. So basically the one roadblock means training the right people in the education institutions so that they can contribute to the industry. That is one. So that is not happening. Why I said roadblock, because people have to, I think the quality of education, the people who are training the student, they should be first trained. So the training is a big process, and India, it doesn't happen so fast. We have to do it. From government side, I think they're encouraging, and the industry side, they're always driven by the technology. They cannot stay alone. They have to move with the technology. So they are doing this. And one thing happening is globalization is more entry is happening now, because they're in the advanced stage of accepting industry four or learning industry four. We are followers. So we should become leaders. That's why I've seen recently, you know, for example, dishwasher, some company has introduced IoT. Immediately people are jumping and taking that machine. So they have got an edge over the other machines. You know? So the industry should also take efforts to take it forward and quickly train their manpower and designers in this field. I don't see otherwise any.
So we have our next question from PSS Murthy, that how can we do research projects in this area? The required equipment is costly and affordability of self-finance institute is not permitting.
No, it is true to some extent. We need money, we need funding. So you should write good proposals and put up to DST, SCRB, AICTE. And you should try that. And many times these proposals, what you write, they are all not of high quality, or there's no novelty in the proposal. There is no clear definition abstract of the proposal, even title of the proposal. You can see they're not matured enough to somebody give sanction of funds. So one is that is very important. That means your proposal writing, how to write, how to justify, that means that your idea, your aim and objectives are very clear. Their chances of sanctioning is high. That is one. Then with the own university and support, you should also slowly build up the maintenance, this equipment. Okay, I agree. It's very difficult without doing, but the equipment is not really that costly. For example, these infrared cameras, they are available on loans also. You can pay small amount, they will give you a camera for loaning. You can use it and give it back. That's kind of things are also possible. Some of these MEMS sensors are very cheap. You can buy them, they're available now. And for research purpose, they will serve, okay. So with industry 4, sometimes the cost of the sensors and all are coming down, okay. And cloud, you don't have to buy computers now. You can go to cloud and use it. That is there. And for academic purpose, it is cheaper now. People have given different costing system for academic purpose. So one way, if you see it is cheaper, one day it is even better. And some conventional equipment is costly, like, you know, olden days we used to use vibration meters, sound level meters, those kind of things are costly. But they're also becoming cheaper now with the new sensors and integrated sensor systems that are coming.
Professor Murthy has also requested that may I request the help from experts in this regard to proposals?
No, it is it is your contacts. You know, if you have somebody, you can always contact and submit your proposal and get it reviewed by him. And this is a good proposal or not, he will give suggestions for improvement. So that is possible. Even somebody sends me, I will do it. Yes, the proposal is not good, then I will tell it is not good. You have to improve on the proposal first.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that. Any other questions from the participants? A thanks from Professor Murthy as well in the chat box. Vivek Sharma has asked that ML and artificial intelligence techniques are still a challenge for mechanical engineers. How one can start learning on its own till curriculum at university level is improved?
Yeah, I don't think either mechanic is it's AI, ML, they are not restricted to one discipline as such. This is like a big cake, something they may use, something you may be useful for you. So it is your desire to learn and your motivation that is important. And you know, the, as you are going with time, many subjects are getting united rather than disintegrated, they're joining. Okay. So that is a con, everybody talking about it. So ML, AI, they're used in every engineering branch now. So you must probably, there will be in your university also, or in other universities also, that there is scope for learning, cross-fertilization is possible, because you know, a mechanical engineer can go and audit courses and computers when such topics are discussed. And Google anyway is there to learn a lot.
Thanks from Vivek Sharma to your reply. Yes, Vivek, a lot of internet resources are there nowadays. In YouTube, you can find free of lectures and you can start learning yes. these techniques. Sir, is there any, I'd like your view, share your view to the participants that for collaboration work, can it be done with the society? So that, because as proposed or written by one of the participants, that we in academics actually are not up to dated, mostly because of most of us are from mechanical background of the all the domains. And so if from your industry partners or from your society, if that help could be provided so that we can have a collaborative work. So that will definitely enrich our domain and we will be updated on what is going on in the industry and as well as we would like to contribute with that knowledge. So I would like to want the participants to know about collaborative works in this area. I mean, first of all, I would like to inform the participants that you can join the society, Condition Monitoring Society. There are several memberships. We have a life membership category also. So you can be a member of this society and you'll be updated up on all the upcoming technologies in this area. And the sir will also...
And student chapter. You can have a student chapter. All the mechanical engineer students and other department students, they can join. And we charge very small amount to conduct a one day program. That is just for students. There is, I don't remember exactly, maybe 200, 300, very small amount only. And those days we used to meet physically and that money was used to give them lunch only, for them only. Now it is update is virtual. So even that cost should not be that much. Except giving for certificate, we give a certificate for that. We take a small amount. And if the student chapter wants us to conduct some program, I can request my colleagues in the Community Condition Society to come forward to help. Yes.
Yes, sir. So students, you can have visit the webpage and you can opt for student membership. For faculties, you can go for life membership and there are other memberships also. So can joint proposals be written with the society? I mean, joint funding proposals.
Yeah, generally society members, if somebody is free, they may help you. But I cannot assure on their behalf that they can do it, but I can do few of them always. Now I keep doing, people keep sending, I just give suggestions and this is not to be, this is to improve. This is not up to the mark, there is no novelty. It's only R&D in this. Sometimes they submit, yeah, just a development work. So for that, nobody will give grant. It has to be some R&D content should be there.
Okay, sir.
So those kind of things. I can suggest and make it better proposal and let them take the chance.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I'll just check the chat box again. So is there any other comment? Okay, so we have a question from Veera Manik Nandan Ramachandra. Can fiber bragg creating sensors be used in helicopter rotor blade?
Yeah, it can be used. When the rotor blade is made, the sensor also should form part of it. Anyway, it's a GRP made material, composite material. So this also can go through that, and the output can be terminated and data can be collected, tapped there, and possible.
I hope your query is answered. Is there any other question? So I meanwhile, I would want to know that are there enough literatures available on the use of fiber optics or fiber sensors?
Fiber gratings.
Yes,
yeah, available. I think you Google it, I think you will get it.
There okay, are some sir.
Few books also.
Okay, sir. And sir, I just want to know whether they can be used for rotating equipments also, rotating machinery, like for plates and all, it's that there is a certain phenomena it will follow. If we want to use it as a sensor for rotating machineries,
rotating machinery also got these days advantage because of wireless transmission. Previously, they used to put some brushes and collect data. That kind of arrangement was there. Suppose a rotating shaft is there. You want to measure torque. So these days that is done by wirelessly. So everywhere now wireless sensors are possible. Yeah, therefore they are there for rotating components. Previously it was not there. Yeah.
Are there any other questions from the participants? If not, then I would like to thank you, sir, for your insightful presentation, and it was really very informative. And I'm sure that after your talk, the participants would agree on how condition monitoring is the central pillar of Industry 4.0. And you have shared different applications of condition monitoring and the different research domains, and that will definitely help most of our participants who are from the mechanical engineering background to expand their horizon, that it's not the core thing which is existing now. If you want to be updated and connected and do something or be in the era of Industry 4.0, we need to expand our knowledge in different horizons and the different domains like wireless sensors, IoT, AR, artificial virtual reality, data analytics, artificial intelligence, machine learning. These are the few of the domains which the you have students here, you can catch them up and connect yourself with the mechanical engineering knowledge and have a multidisciplinary research area. And your introduction on this concept of digital twin was really new to many of us, and definitely you have shared its future research scope. So that would definitely impart enthusiasm among these participants, and they can have explore its opportunity and how the condition monitoring is done for aircraft aircraft during design stage itself. Then we have subsea cable monitoring. So that really gave us a good insight on the different aspects of condition monitoring. And in this, I would like to personally invite you to Aligarh Muslim University after this COVID situation ends, so that we can again have a nice interaction and we can benefit from your knowledge and experience, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your precious time at FTP.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Siddhar Kanam, for inviting me, and also thank you, your organization, for facilitating this lecture. And as you said, I don't know when COVID will clear, but definitely I would like to visit AMU. It's a very well-established university, and I would like to definitely visit your department and your university. And I wish for the best to happen in the future. I wish you, all of you, the very best in your endeavors, all the endeavors, research endeavors, and lifelong endeavors. Thank you very much. Good luck. Take care. Bye.
Thank you very much, sir. And I would request if you could share the PDF of your talk so that participants, actually the request, and we have an examination at the end. So if you don't mind, you please share the PDF of your talk. We can share it forward.
Yeah, with you. I will send the PPT to you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much, sir.
By today or tomorrow, I'll send. Okay.
Most welcome. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir, for your time.
Sure. Bye.